Hello, everybody. Welcome back to the Satanic Media Agenda Exposed on the Sunday, February 28th, the last day of February 2021. Michael in Germany is joined with me, and we're going to delve back into the strange topic of the media and the deep, deep, deep ditch that we have fallen into through the promotion of movies and fictitious characters and all of these different scenarios and ideologies into the 21st century. And here we are with a so-called global pandemic in February, late February. And it's definitely a very interesting place to be, Michael. And I want to thank you for taking the time to make the script in German and work with it in English with us today.
Hello, Brett, and hello, dear listeners. Welcome back again to one of the main issues here. It's about false idols. It's about the industry which uses young people to influence the masses. We know that it's a very old topic. They did it before and they will do it in the future, but we have chosen here James Dean as a prime example. And I was very, very astonished to learn that even when I did it afterwards, when I did it in English, I did it in German with Jörg, and he was very much into it. He said, oh, that's really great and really interesting, because you see that he's just in such a household name when people remember, and this program especially, of course, is for the older generation, so 40 plus, 50 plus, something like that. So who remembers all these false idols from the past, being Marilyn Monroe, Jim Morrison, Jimi Hendrix, Elvis Presley, Jane Mansfield.
Yes, and then going into the 80s, which was even stranger and more, what should we say, risque, you know, the sexual advances, revolution was making some serious deep gouges into the family. And, you know, the conservatives in America were very upset, as usual. But we've just seen a progressive decline of the quote-unquote moral standards. And I don't think this is just subject to America. It's subject to the world, because America has produced so many of these ideologies, Michael. It's at a fever pitch. It's been going on. They've been spending all of this time and resources on these ideologies. For what reason? We're looking into the reason. We're telling you that there's nothing new under the sun. The same methods that were deployed in the past are being deployed again now, only under different circumstances, I suppose.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure. That's about it's about the time. In the 1950s, there was a higher moral standard than nowadays, and so we are facing the fact that James Dean was a rebel with a red jacket and with a cigarette.
That's right, Michael, because we had World War II, which was tremendously devastating, especially in Europe, and all of these people killed and institutions destroyed. And of course, let's look at the fact that the target through all of this, as we've learned in our very controversial study of the Roman Catholic Church, has been the Protestants. The Council of Trent has been upheld throughout the centuries. This is the big picture. It's the really bad news that no one wants to hear. Mm-hmm. But what our Bible says is be wise as serpents and as harmless as doves. So in order to be as wise as a serpent, you need to think like a serpent. You need to act like a serpent. You need to know where they stand. Excuse me, you don't need to act like one, but you're capable of acting like one. The point is, you don't need to be afraid of it. It's not going to kill you. You need to be aware of it. You need to know that these methods are being used today. It's not just in the Holocaust here. The Holocaust was mentioned hundreds of years ago. This stuff isn't new. They were burning people with their Bibles. Mm-hmm. This is nothing new. And of course, the Jews, salvation is of the Jews. It's not of the Gentiles. Jesus was a Jew. He wasn't a Gentile. Oh, so we attack the Jews because they run the banks? It's just absurd what's going on, Michael.
Mm, yeah, it is.
It's absurd, and we need to say enough is enough.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then let's dive in into James Dean, because I think that the listeners out there will really want to know what happened with James Dean and what purpose was he used for. I think that we have handled some subjects already, but now let's get in deeper into that. Maybe we get into some of the really nitty-gritties, because there's much, much, much disinfo out there, which has been added and added and added since his death in 1955, making it 66 years now that he had a fatal car accident. And there's much, much, much to it. You only have to combine the dots. You have to think for yourself, and then you will find a solution of the whole dilemma. And dilemma being the sticker which James Dean had on his motorcycle. So he was in a dilemma too. It was called, the sticker was, has been named Dean's Dilemma. Okay, so let's move on. That was the German poster of his movie East of Eden with Natalie Wood. Okay, and this picture, we are getting facts straight now. This picture also represents a so-called American rebel. This label has been given to James Dean by Ronald Reagan, your former American president, by the way. Okay. So next up, what's about this movie also? It's about the movie here. Rebel Without a Cause, not East of Eden. I have to apologize for mixing it up. So Rebel Without a Cause. So what's about the movie here? You see that all the actors in the main actors in the movie didn't had any luck afterwards. James Dean died in the fatal car accident. Natalie Wood drowned. We go into that later. And also his sidekick here in the movie Rebel Without a Cause, Sal Mineo, has been murdered. In 1955, when Mr. Sal Mineo played the character Plato Crawford in Rebel Without a Cause, opposite to James Dean, he was being risen in popularity. In 1967, he directed Fortune and Man's Eye, an LGBT theme play, because he was apparently homosexual. Okay, so he has a young age and homosexual label, and therefore he had it a little bit hard in the 1960s, 70s to achieve roles and make his living. So on February the 12th, 1976, a nine-year-old neighbor sitting in her bedroom, a nine-year-old girl, Monica Merrim, heard a shout of a man calling for help. Another neighbor rushed to the alleyway and identified Mineo struggling to stay alive after being stabbed. He was being stabbed. He was pronounced dead. And for years, his murder remained a mystery, with some speculation that his homosexuality being the motive behind the crime. And afterwards, his murderer, he claims that he didn't know anything about the popularity or the identity of his victim, believe it or not. I think that he was kind of a household name, but you see that maybe he was not only unlucky, but there was not more to it. I didn't go into that because we have a massive amount of strange cases in the James Dean not saying family, but in the Actors Guild or in the actors' crew, it is really interesting, and it's also frightening. You won't see almost nobody who had good luck, who was making a decent living and raising a family. These are all egocentric characters, And therefore, you see, it is very hard. They pretend to play a part and they are being misleading the audience, but it doesn't turn out good. You see that in the case of Elvis Presley or Marilyn Monroe or James Dean or Sal Mineo now. Now, all these four people, these actors, have not been very lucky in their life. They were prominent, but they weren't lucky. They didn't make it to see their child's being raised or something like that. No, he just was 37 years old. Okay, but that's not everything which is very strange about these movies that James Dean did. Dean said he wanted to direct a movie and his favorite movie was Antoine de Saint-Exupéry, The Little Prince. Mm-hmm. Okay. So let's skip it because I'm not going into the thing that James Dean doesn't need 18 sessions or something like that. But at the end of the movie, Giants would watch his last movie and he didn't saw his premiere because he died shortly after the screenplay was done. Mr. Taylor presented him a cat, and that's for Brett. And that was the only reason why I placed a cat in here. Because I know that Brett carries two cats and he loves them. He loves them very much. And as long as he's feeding them, they love him also.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I don't know if this is the very cat that Elizabeth Taylor was making him as a gift, but I know that it has been said, rumor has it, that he was giving a cat by maybe this or another cat, I don't know, by Elizabeth Taylor. Okay, so he was into cats. Okay.
So in other words, he had a cat woman.
Yeah.
Guess what?
Okay.
Little secret, what? Michael, I had a cat woman too. So
That's
why Brett's a cat fanatic.
That's right. So what would have been turned out if James Dean wouldn't have died on the highway?
Mm.
They were having meetings, they were having discussions, they were having an agreement that in the following 6 years he should star in 9 other Warner Brothers movies. And he also wanted to found and to erect his own movie and television projects company, something like that. And the contract should have been signed in the first week of October 1955. And he died on the 30th of September. So he was going to make it big time. Unless there came the accident. Okay. The next movie which he should play it was this particular movie. In return, Dean will undertake to act in 9 Warner Brothers films over the next 6 years. In addition, Dean asked to found his own production company for film and television projects, which should operate under the umbrella of the Warner Brothers. The contract was supposed to be signed in the first week of October 1955. If Warner Brothers had agreed to the deal, Dean would have started the next film. Before that, however, he would had to return off the film Hell Is In Me, a film biography planned by MGM about the boxer Rocky Graziano, as well as 2 television films. Well, Hell Is In Me, interesting title, huh? For one who died a few days before signing the contract. Well, Hell Is In Me is only the German title. The original title is Somebody Up There Likes Me. And James Dean was replaced by Paul Newman, and look, whose his female leading part is. It's Pier Angeli, the woman, or the one, the girl, that James Dean supposedly loved. So if anybody benefits from the death of James Dean, it was Paul Newman. I'm not telling in any kind, case, shape, or form that Paul Newman has anything to do with the accident of James Dean. Don't get me wrong. But there were a bunch of young guys, of young rebels on the cinema screen who wanted to make it. And James Dean was just one of many. There were, for example, Marlon Brando. There was Paul Newman. And there were numerous other people who are just waiting to get a decent part, to make it, to get a career done. And so Paul Newman was the lucky one as the replacement of James Dean, in that case, playing a boxer. But that also means that James Dean would have played another rebel. It's a boxer. It's not about arguments. It's about fighting and handing over money for fights. Okay, so we see he would have been starred again as a rebel character. Can we agree on that? Okay, and somebody up there likes me. Who said somebody? If it is about a boxer who is violating other people and kicking and boxing other, or not kicking, but kicking butts, so to say, other people and making a living on that. You see, it is not the Christian way to deal with people, to hit him or hit him hard. Yeah. So who's the one who likes him, who's up there? It must be Satan. And this is also a code phrase. Somebody up there likes you or likes me. There is, for example, an instrumental track on the New God Dream album from the Simple Minds from 1981, which is called Somebody Up There Likes You. So, moving on. We had a bit of a discussion, and I have censored the last episode with
yes,
topless Ursula Andress. Mm-hmm. And Ursula Andress was the girl which was the last one that James Dean approached on the day he died. And Ursula Andress is very famous, not about her Swiss descent, and her father is most likely also a diplomat. And she was very young at the age. At this time, she must have been around 19 or 20 or something like that. And the two were just dating, or weren't they? Yeah. You see, at the time, he couldn't have Pierre Angeli, and then he was dating Ursula Andress, it seems. And on the very day that he was dying, we will sort it out. You will be very surprised. By the way, this is Ursula Andress now properly dressed, not undressed, but dressed, with Sean Connery in the very first James Bond movie, 1962. James Bond, about Hinduism, about a hero who doesn't have any family or children in the entire life. In the entire life of this figure from 1962 to 2020, in the entire almost 60-year lifespan, James Bond is a woman hunter. He's out for fun. Yeah, he's an ego type. He kills people. He has the license to kill, like James Bond, of course. Yeah, so you see, it's just about barely dressed women. It's about having fun. It's about beach and sun, and everything is okay. Everything is nice. Not about marriage, raising kids, or
being responsible.
Caring about your grandparents. Nothing about that, huh? That's James Bond. And killing people, no? Not to forget. No? Ian Fleming's, it's a secret service agent, Ian Fleming. Dr. No, the first James Bond adventure, starring the 24-year-old Ursula Andress. So she was, very, very young when she approached James Dean. I think she was 18 or something. Okay, so let's move on. This is a very famous picture about Ursula Andress. Not going into that, but this is just that Ursula Andress was dating James Dean, or so it seemed, with a cigarette. Okay. And on that very day, on the 13th of September, Ursula Andress remembered in the morning at 7 o'clock, he picked me up at home, and she said, and James Dean said, come on, Ursula, we are driving together, heading towards San Francisco. And at that moment, her later husband, or her future husband, John Derrick, approached, and James saw John, and he knew that I love John. Okay, if it is so, then I am asking myself, why do they kiss? But, that's Hollywood, huh? I suppose. And he said, okay, John, let's go on for a ride. And he was speeding with John through the village. So not speeding on the racetrack or on the highway. No, speeding in the village. to have a conversation among men. And afterwards, he returned and he approached Ursula Andress by saying, "I now know that you won't come with me." And then he got away. And a few hours later, Mr. James Dean was heading into the sunset on his last journey. Interesting, huh? So, once and for all, it was this car that James Dean bought from all the money he got from the film Giants. It was a Porsche 550 Spider, the so-called Giant Killer. Oh, Giant was the name of his last movie. Okay. Interesting enough is there is a special insert that also Brett Norman is totally unaware of. This special insert I will, as the name says, I will insert here, and then you see the double meaning of Mr. James Dean. On the one hand, he is promoting traffic security and don't speed on the highway on public roads. But in private life, he was always speeding with John Derek, with Ursula Andress, and several other starlets and several other people told about the few days that Mr. James Dean had purchased his Porsche. I think it was about 8 or 10 days before he died. He only had the car for that short period of time. And he was speeding everywhere. So he was showing off, he was having fun, but that was that. You see that he was not a caring, gentle type, and he wants to hit it hard. Yeah? He was a character, he was a little bit depressive, a little bit maniac, you know, bipolar disorder. We all got into that. And this is very strange because there is an official advertisement on the internet from a few days. You see, 17 September, 13 days before his fatal crash. Yeah, I will go into that so that Brett has then the knowledge what's it all about. I will insert it here, and you see that he promotes something that he himself does not do. Yeah, so he's not an honest guy. He's just doing it for the television and advises people not to speed and be cautious. And what's very, very, very frightening is the last sentence. Yeah, drive carefully because maybe it's me whom you save the life. And that's very strange for someone who 13 days later is being killed in a traffic accident.
James Dean. Hi, Jimmy.
Hi, Gig.
We asked Jimmy over today because he's a racing man himself. A real one, not a crazy one. Incidentally, I think I should explain that Jimmy just stepped over from the set of Giant. And need I add, he plays a Texan. Speaking of racing, have you ever been in a drag race?
Are you kidding me?
I just thought I'd ask. No, Jim races in the tradition, you might say. Real racing cars, real tracks. How fast will your car go?
Oh, an honest miles an hour. Clocked, it'd run about 106, 7.
You've won a few races, haven't you?
Oh, one or two.
Where?
Well, I showed pretty good at Palm Springs. I ran a Bakersfield.
Jimmy, we probably have a great many young people watching our show tonight, and for their benefit, I'd like your opinion about fast driving on the highway. Do you think it's a good idea?
A good point. I used to fly around quite a bit, you know. Took a lot of unnecessary chances on the highways. And I started racing, and now I drive on the highways, I'm extra cautious. Because no one knows what they're doing half the time. You don't know what this guy's gonna do with that one. On a track, there are a lot of men who spend a lot of time developing rules and ways of safety. And I find myself being very cautious on the highway. I don't have the urge to speed on the highway. People say racing is dangerous, but I'll take my chances on the track any day than on a highway.
Well, Gig, I think I'd better take off.
Oh, wait a minute, Jimmy. One more question. Do you have any special advice for the young people who drive?
Take it easy driving. The life you might save might be mine.
The life you might save, it might be mine.
Ah, okay.
So, and 13 days later, he died in a Porsche. And that's the first one of the strange coincidences of surrounding the death of James Dean. That's just the first one. By the way, the presenter also had an unlucky death, too. It will go now one in a row. One, bam, 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 bam. You see, everybody who's, or almost everybody is in the industry, they get not lucky. But you see that he said his last television approach was take it easy driving. The life you might save, it might be mine. Like a precaution or something like that. A premonition or something like that, you see.
Right.
It's, very strange. It's really very strange, that interview. Yeah. Okay. So that's that. And let's move on. In September 1955, James Dean bought his second race car, a silver-colored Porsche 550 Spyder. On the front lid of the car was the number 130, 113, so 130. Yeah, 130 is not a positive number if you go into the numerology of things. And on the back of the car, there was a nickname called Little Bastard. But people do really think that is the nickname of the car, but isn't. It is the nickname of James Dean. Yeah. It's misconception everywhere, because his dialogue coach, Mr. Bill Hickman, has labeled him that way on the set of Giants on his last movie. And from this car, the Porsche 550, there were only 82 pieces been manufactured. 78 were ready to sell or ready to be sold. And the owner of the car house Competition Motors in Hollywood, John von Neumann, had only 5 been imported in the United States of America. So imagine James Dean, as a known speeder, as a race car enthusiast, and as a member of, or as a participant in race cars, he bought one of only 5 Porsche race cars in the United States at that time. I tell that because usually Donald Turnipseed, his opponent in the car crash, which overlooked him, obviously, could not figure it out what kind of car it was which was approaching to the crossing, Brett. If you only have 5 cars who are about, I don't know, for exactly 45 inches high or something like that on the highway, yeah, you don't know that car. If there are only 5 cars of that in the United States of America, you don't have a chance in 1955 to look upon the internet and say, oh, what new cars are coming up? This was a brand new car who was legal to drive on the road, but just 5 pieces of that car were registered or sold in the United States at that time. 5.
What a number, huh?
Yeah. So to achieve that, he has been given away his old Porsche Super Speedster, which he had been racing with also, and he has $3,000 balance to be paid. And he wanted to participate at the racetrack on the 1st of October 1955 in Salinas in California. At the medical check-in, Dean was being said he had a terrific state of health. And but days before, Mr. James Dean had a small accident on the Sunset Boulevard, speaking of Los Angeles, so that the Porsche had to be repaired before getting ready for the racetrack. So he had that car only from the 17th of September, okay? But between the 70s and the 30s, he had already a small accident. And it will be later be seen that maybe there were more than one accident in the meantime. But it will get more strange, Brett. I can promise you it will get very strange. Mm-hmm. So the Porsche had to be repaired before the race. In these days, he visited his father. And one of the last people who he met at the 13th of September 1955 was the also race enthusiast multimillionaire called Lance Reventlow. And everybody who is into the James Dean story must now yell and said, oh, wow, he, him, yes, I know that story. I hope you do. Because he was one of the last people he saw on the way to his accident. Let's go into that. There are several people he did met on the day of his death. There was Ursula Andress, which we had talked about earlier. There was her next future husband, John Derrick, of course. They were the people who are driving the station wagon behind him, Bill Hickman and Stanford Roth, the photographer, and his accompanied mechanic called Rolf Wüterich. So, there are a number of people he met on that very day, on a special day on the 13th of September. What is that kind of a stamp? Well, you see that the name of his co-driver and his mechanic at the same time is Rolf Wüterich, with TH. But Wüterich is also a German phrase for someone who is very, very fast getting angry. And destroying things, something like that.
Yeah, we say people with a short fuse, yeah?
Yeah, even like a short fuse, yeah. Berserker, yeah?
Yeah.
Something like that, yeah? Mm-hmm. So, especially the name is also interesting, huh? And his accompanied mechanic was also a race car driver. Yeah, he was at the Tour de France for automobiles 1964 on a Porsche. So Porsche team himself used him not only as a mechanic, but also a race car driver. So he was accompanied on the last trip by a race car driver and race car mechanic. I think you now slowly get the picture that James Dean has nothing to do with family trips, picnics, something like that. He has to do with fast cars, beautiful women, great guys, and the movie industry and racetracks. Okay. So his fellow is called Rolf Wüterich, and I think that we go into that a little bit later, because otherwise you won't understand the deep impact that this accident was gonna make. These are the two main opponents. This is James Dean in his Porsche, and this is Donald Turnipseed in his Ford. Yeah? You can imagine
that car is
how small and how low profile that car is.
Man, it's called a death trap, Michael.
Yes. And if you're on the driver's seat and you won't have any seat belts in 1955.
Oh, man.
And you approach that kind of a car, which is, I think, about three times the weight as yours and has a higher center of gravity, yeah, it smashes you totally. And we're going into that. It's not a nice matter, I know. But nevertheless, you see, the official story is that this guy, Donald Turnipseed, not Speed, but Donald Turnipseed, has overlooked James Dean and did a strange zigzag maneuver. I saw him, I have to brake, and no, I have to accelerate, and now I have to brake again, something like that. So it's a zigzag or on-off action, and this is the official cause of the death of James Dean. But is it? Is it really? Because you see that I did that script in several languages, and it has a little bit of a background. The background is that there is so much deception and so much disinformation about the death of James Dean It's absolutely not funny, and it's absolutely not funny, and everybody who is involved in that doesn't tell you the entire truth for several reasons, I think. So pardon me, because I have to skip it here already. I have to think about how I proceed with the script. Yeah. Okay, so Porsche used to have low profile and low weight cars for racing because after the Second World War, post-war, German engines didn't have a V8 in it or big numbers of horsepower. So they got away with 90 horsepower, something like that. So it was a very decent amount. So they had built less weight. So the cars were very agile, but also not agile, but also fragile, because you see that if you don't carry much weight, then the thin metal will soon be damaged in any case of an accident. Okay. The problem is now that people think that the evolution of news means an improvement of information, and that isn't true. Because what absolutely amazes me is that everybody who's got into the accident of Mr. James Dean promotes that, oh, there are new clues, there are new tests, there are new developments, and now we have computer models. I find it not amusing, Brett, that people don't think straight, but have to use computers to get the idea of something about, you know, the system, when you tell somebody the truth and he tells it to another friend and another friend. So the outcome after 66 years could be quite different.
Oh, so you're telling me they're using sophistication, correct?
Yeah.
Yeah. And what is sophistication, Michael? What's the root of sophistication?
Oh, this is a so-called man's philosophy, if you like to say so.
You mean sophistry.
Sophistry, yes, of course.
What was it we study now? We study the Bible and the adversary. We specifically mentioned be as wise as serpents. Mm-hmm. And what do the serpents do? They like to disguise themselves in a garb of Christianity. Mm-hmm. They like to pretend that they're shepherds in wolf's clothing.
Mm-hmm.
They do. So what is it they use? Oh, casuistry? What's casuistry? Oh, cases of conscience, Michael. Mm-hmm. Oh, and then what's the other one? Sophistry. Well, we're living in the world of sophistry today in the 21st century, aren't we?
Mm-hmm.
Look at all of the new technological developments and look at all of the people that are involved with these developments. I'm even involved with them.
Mm-hmm.
There's no innocence here. We're all guilty of this.
For example, there is a consulting firm called Exponent. And it had nothing to do with neutrality, because you see that even Wikipedia states that the quality and neutrality of reports produced by the company have been called into question on various controversial topics. Interesting, huh? So everybody gets his statements or their studies. You make your studies according to those who pay you. Isn't that interesting in the 2020-21 times when there are so many studies out there which tell you, oh yeah, this college and this university has presented a new study which shows ... Yeah, of course, the studies always show the things that the ones who have been paying these studies would like to have as a result. And that's the same thing here in the James Dean story. You see here, for example, here, they came to the conclusion that the speed of travel of Dean's vehicle at that time of the accident must have been 55 or 58 miles per hour. Can you read that?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So, okay, that was that much years later, okay? But that company called Exponent has been known that they are not quite so neutral, okay? According to Los Angeles Times, Exponent's research has come under fire from critics, including engineers, attorneys, and academics who say the company tends to deliver to clients the reports they need to mount a public defense. Mm-hmm. So, what about the old-fashioned way by collecting facts and then sorted out what is most likely and what is absolutely unlikely to happen on the very fatal accident of James Dean and what led to his star rise in stardom? The first issue is that brand called Porsche. This is a German brand which is very famous for having racing cars and usual street legal cars at the same time. The inventor of that brand actually worked also for Adolf Hitler, because Professor Porsche...
Red and black, I see, Michael, in this mm-hmm. coat of arms, yes.
Mm-hmm. And a prancing horse like Ferrari, but you see yes. that it's just the German kind of sport vehicle. Yeah, but you see that the roots going far beyond Auto Union and all these race cars and world record cars in the 1920s, 1930s. And Professor Porsche was the inventor of the so-called Volkswagen Beetle. And he was having very narrow ties with the German Reich. Yeah, very narrow ties. And after the war, all these big manufacturers like BMW or Mercedes-Benz and Porsche, they will soon be reactivated again for the mobilization of the German community. Of course, not with big V8s, but just slowly emerging. So there was no trial about or against the people who have built these engines for the planes, for the tanks, for the motorcycles, for the cars, etc.
Oh, that's interesting you bring that up. Jörg had mentioned Ford in Germany.
Yeah, sure. Yeah. Ford, mm-hmm. Ford has had and still has manufacturing in Cologne, in Germany. That's there where officially the remains of the three holy kings are being buried. Yeah, there are no three holy kings, it's just the three wise men mentioned in the Bible, but the Cologne Cathedral claims that they have buried the remains of that so-called kings. Yeah. That's Cologne is it's a very old Catholic big city in.
Yes, I've been there actually. I was there in 1989 when I visited Europe.
Yeah. Okay.
Yep.
Yeah. So an Exponent's executive chairman responded such a criticism as a cheap shot, responding, quote, "Do we tell our clients a lot of what they don't want to hear? Absolutely. I reckon not." Okay. Because you see that it is about the speed of the vehicle, which everybody talks about, and James Dean. Was it his fault or the other fault? You see that he claimed what you just saw at an advertisement or as a TV documentary, that he does not take any chances on the highway, but on the racetrack, okay? So the highway is not a racetrack, correct? Because in the United States, also in 1955, there were speed limits. Okay, so what's about it? So another expert of team or a team of expert in 2008 have an analysis running for the National Geographic that Dean had 70 to 75 miles per hour as the speed just before the impact or the accident happened. I think that's quite a difference to 55, huh? 70 or 55. I think these 50 miles per hour could make a difference. So this is a contradiction. How many claims do you want to have? 5, 4, 6, 8? You can have numerous ones. But let's go into the real purpose of what James Dean is all about. Wasn't his nickname Little Bastard or the American Rebel? Do you really think by any means that he who has got a brand new race car out on the highway in 1955, he was just being labeled an American rebel and driving cars for racing, but he did not speed? Okay, let's move on. Expert accident reconstruction.com, James Dean story. quote. Reconstructing James Dean fatal crash. That is the remains.
Oof, man. That doesn't look like 58 miles an hour.
As you know, the tragic crash occurred September the 13th at 5:45 p.m. near Joleme, California. It has been the subject of many independent investigations and research studies over the years. Recently, National Geographic decided to review it again using a different approach and new crash science. Ah, she blinded me with science. Science is the new religion, especially since 2020. Science is the new religion.
Right.
We will compare the science of today with the original facts from 1955, and you will be very amazed to learn how big the difference will be. Mm. So newer doesn't mean better. There is just one truth. There cannot be two truths at the same time. You cannot be driven 55 or 75 miles an hour at the same time. So who's right and who's wrong? Okay. Their research has discovered visible statement and asked us to participate and use modern approach in a new reconstruction. We eagerly volunteered and it was a great opportunity to show the world our latest software technology. Okay. The background. James Dean was en route to an amateur road race in Salinas, coming from Los Angeles, so heading north or northwest. He was driving his brand new, 13 days old, 1955 Porsche 550, which he had just purchased for the purpose of amateur racing activities. He was accompanied by Rolf Wüterich, a German mechanic sent by Porsche to support new American owners of racing Porsches. They took a road that caused them to pass through Joleme, California on Highway 46. Shortly before the crash, Dean was pulled over by a California highway officer and ticketed for speeding. And now comes the contradiction. This is no original photo. Known to me. So I don't know where this photo comes from, if it is photoshopped or not. It is. We have to be very careful. I know number 130 is fitting, and this is one guy in the car.
It's just a recreation.
It's a recreation. So yeah. Approximately at 5:45 p.m., Dean was westbound passing through the Ypsilon intersection at Highway 41, 1 mile east of Joleme. At that point, Donald turned upseat. This is a typo. Driving a 1954 business coupe, turned left in front of Dean, and then the collision occurred. Dean was killed almost immediately, and Wüterich was ejected from the Porsche and found beside the driver's side of the car at final rest. Dean was found slumped against the passenger's door, which sparked a long-standing controversy about who was driving. Turn-up seat rotated counterclockwise and slid sideways from impact to rest about 38 feet east of the impact point. Dean's Porsche traveled about 45 feet from impact to rest in a northern direction. California Highway Patrol officials attended the scene and took some photographs and basic measurements. So, many questions arise. Was there a lack of visibility? Yeah, because, of course, the car was low profile, just five cars in the United States, so nobody could imagine what's that kind of a car. Is it really a car? Is it a bird? Is it a plane? Is it what is it? It is 1955.
Yeah.
It is 1955, and the average student drives an average car from his old man, an average V8, kind of a lorry, track, Ford, something like that, sedan, etc. So the cars that James Dean himself used in Rebel Without a Cause, for example. Did Dean brake before the impact? What were the impact speeds? Was James Dean really driving? Okay. So that is James Dean coming from east, heading here. And this is Donald Turnup's seat, wanted to take the left turn. And this is a crossing without any lights. Yeah. So people, if the road is clear, can drive without any braking, any deacceleration whatsoever left. On that. So it's very dangerous crossing. That is the very crash site. Okay. We were provided with a series of photographs of the scene taken by California Highway Patrol officers. We were supplied with their reports and a sketch. The sketches were great for 1955, but lacked the accuracy of modern day scale diagrams. Yeah, you see that everybody, if you try to publish a true video with 240p resolution, everybody won't talk about the content of the video, but oh, did you record it with the toaster? Yeah, so people intend to think that the quality of a video image has something to do with the reality, which has absolutely no effect. The content, the truth is important, not if it has been written down, it's been pinned down, been sketched down, been recorded on audio, video, video 8, VHS, digital, analog, whatsoever. Yeah, you see that people always think that the newer the better, and modern science can solve everything. The problem is that scientists are most of them, or many of them, are not honest, because they have been paid to get a proper result from the ones who are giving the money. Yeah,
that's right, Michael. Absolutely.
So they did a very, very intense reconstruction using photogrammetry, etc., etc. You can do everything you want, but if your first clues and your first line of thinking isn't correct, you won't get the proper result. So we do not go into every simulation here and every aspect, but we go on the things which really happened on that day. So if you like to recreate that scene, you are in big trouble, because the brake signs on the pavement, yeah, the brake lines on the pavement doesn't tell you how fast someone's driving, for example, because it doesn't tell you how fast someone is hitting the brakes. And then you have to think about the fact that the 1955 brakes had nothing in common with 2020 brakes on the car. So you see that so many things, and we're getting very technical soon. But nevertheless, the analysis showed, yeah, okay, that the Ford had 31 miles per hour and the Porsche 63 miles per hour. So it looks like James Dean was a bit off speeding, but not that much, and it would get not any result why this accident really occurred. It's just numbers. Yeah, but the Ford is much more heavier than the Porsche. So James Dean was sitting in the passenger seat. I'm very in the driver's seat. Sorry, I'm very convinced about that, because his foot was being locked between the clutch and the brake, something like that. So it is very unlikely that his passenger Wolf Witterich took the steering or took the switched positions. It is very unlikely. It is more unlikely that the man who's driving at that moment, will be clamped and been fixed under the pedals, and the passenger being thrown out at the impact. Yeah. Also, the one who was deadly wounded was James Dean, and he was the one who was getting hit quite nearby the Ford, if you see what I mean. Okay. So let's move on. When the Delta V's, doesn't that sound great, like Star Wars, something like that. From momentum were aligned, we had impact speeds in the range of 70 to 75 for the Dean Porsche. Oh, interesting. Yeah. There it is, 63. There it is, 75. And 55 to 60 for the turn-up seat Ford. Once again, it is Mr. Turn-up seat. What is that? Yeah, I thought it was a proper examination. Why didn't they get the name right? Any results expressed with greater precision would be realistic when we consider the accuracy of the foundation data. Once again, that is the smash car of Mr. James Dean. You wouldn't expect someone to get to be that lucky to be unhurt in that accident, won't you?
Mm-hmm. Well, so, I know what it is, Michael. You know what a turnip is? It's a type of plant. I forget now. It's is it a root vegetable, I believe, a turnip, and it's spelt with an I. So instead of turn up, they're thinking turnip. Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah. Turnip seed. Okay. So it's a turnip seed. No, a turn up.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. It's just, someone's thinking about the thing that they're not thinking proper. Mm-hmm. That's all. Mm-hmm. That's all that is.
Yeah. So question arose, who was really driving? The Dean vehicle rotated violently in a counterclockwise fashion, which relieved the occupant forces and explained why the mechanic Rolf was found outside the vehicle on the driver's side at final rest. So, rotated violently, we will face the fact that it is not quite correct. But what is it to it? Why did it happen? Why did turnip seed turn in front of Dean? And what's it all about? You see that in any result is the death of an idol, the death of an actor. But you see, the real problems occurred after the death, because after the death he went into superstardom. And some teenagers also followed Dean by committing suicide. So much was the impact of the dying idol. And 3 years after his death, he received more letters than any other living Hollywood star. Can you imagine that? Can you really imagine that? That during the funeral, people were digging out earth and grass and flowers as reliquiae, as items of worship, something like that. Yeah, so it is extremely, extremely, extremely strange. Yeah? James Dean had become a cult hero, the undying personification of rebellious youth. He certainly did affect people. When news of his sudden and untimely death reached Elizabeth Taylor, one of his co-stars in Giant, she collapsed and had to be hospitalized for 5 days, the story goes, and she barely knew him. Okay, she knew about his molestation and she was handing him over a cat. So yeah. she barely knew him? I don't think so.
Wrong.
I don't think so. Okay. So there are many musicians singing about him. Phil Ox, The Eagles, On the Border of the title, James Dean, American Pie, Don McLean has been mentioned. Movie star Harpo, Vogue of Madonna, These Days from Bon Jovi, numerous people, Billy Joel, Taylor Swift, etc., etc. But I think you won't like to have any things but the truth. And the truth is that these both have met. And Elvis Presley had said, I don't want to be compared to James Dean. Because, there's also an insert, James Dean is a genius, or was a genius. Yeah? So Elvis Presley really, have looked it up, said that James Dean was a genius. Maybe he was a genius actor. He was a genius.
They predict that Elvis Presley will be another James Dean. Now, have you heard that?
I've heard something about it. But I would never compare myself in any way to James Dean, because James Dean was a genius.
This is the James Dean Memorial Junction. Most famous for James Dean. Many people, I suppose that many people have been died there, but the world only speaks of James Dean because he was an idol, he was a household name. So we're speaking about the death of James Dean. He was 24 years old. And he was on his way to Salinas to a car race, okay? He purchased a Triumph Tiger motorcycle and later he used a red MG sports car. Then he traded the MG for a new Porsche Speedster in 1955. And in later 1955, he exchanged his motorbike. And then he, later in 1955, he exchanged the Porsche, which he had sold in the same year for a newer and much, much faster one. Huh? Okay. Just before filming began on Rebel Without a Cause, Dean competed in a palm string road races with his Speedster, so with the first Porsche, on March 26th to 27th. He finished first overall in Saturdays, or Sabbaths, Novice class, and second overall on his Sunday main event. He also raced the Speedster at Bakersfield. We have just found out in that advertisement about road safety, remember, Brett?
Mm-hmm.
Finishing first in class and third overall. His final race with the Speedster was at Santa Barbara on Memorial Day, May the 13th, where he started in the 18th position, worked his way up to the fourth before over-revving his engine and blowing a piston. He did not finish the race. So he didn't want to just participate. He did want to win. He over-revved his engine. Okay, it could be an accident, Kurt, that you have changed the wrong gear. Okay, but you see that he went from the 18th position, worked his way up to the 4th. So he must have had talent. That's him in his old Porsche Speedster. Okay, that kind of thing had way less horsepower and was not that fast as his later car. During the filming of Giant from June to mid-September, Warner Brothers had barred Dean from all racing activities. In July, Dean put down a deposit on a new Lotus Mark 9 sports racer, but then the car was delayed until autumn. So, then the Porsche Spyder came up in his mind. And the Porsche Spyder did win several races in its class. For example, in Sebring International Raceway and in the 24 Hours of Le Mans in 1955, the very year that James Dean had his fatal accident and has purchased that Porsche Spyder. The 24 Hours of Le Mans took place on 11 and 12 June, so James Dean was alive and well, making the movie Giants. It was the fourth round of the FIA World Sports Car Championship. During the race, Pierre Levy crashed into a crowd of spectators, killing 84 and injuring 120 in the deadliest accident in motor racing history. So everybody knew that car racing could be fatal, not only for the drivers, but also for the general public or the spectators. On September the 21st, as Dean was finishing Giant, he suddenly traded in his Speedster at Competition Motors for a new, more powerful and faster 1955 Porsche 550 Spyder and entered the upcoming Salinas Road Race. Oh, I take my chances only on the racetrack, he said. Which was scheduled for the next day, meaning October the 1st. He also purchased a new 1955 Ford Country Squire station wagon to use for towing the so-called Little Bastard to and from the races and an open-wheel car trailer. And that is incorrect. Because Little Bastard is not the nickname for the car. You see how many contradictions and errors there are into that. So during that making of the film The Giants, James Dean and his dialogue trainer Bob Hinkle, they have shot 261 rabbits and 2 coyotes. I'd say that doesn't sound very much Christian-like, does it? When you shoot 261 rabbits just for fun. During a 5-week long take on the movie Giants, they went at night to hunt down rabbits, and at the end of the of the movie they had shot 261 rabbits and 2 coyotes, Brett. That makes about eight rabbits each night to be shot dead. Okay. James Dean just only got $20,000 for Giants, while Elizabeth Taylor received $175,000 and Rock Hudson $100,000. That, I'd say, was very cheap. Yeah, and so he had to ask for money from his movie company to buy the Porsche. Okay. This is supposedly the last picture taken from Stanford Roth from the Ford Country Wagon and in passenger seat, depicting James Dean in his Porsche 550 Spyder being accompanied by the German race mechanic Rolf Wieterich. Okay? You see the number 130. You see he's got sunglasses. His co-driver does not wear any sunglasses because I have read in an interview that he has simply forgotten the sunglasses. So he's on the steering wheel and he's wearing racing gloves or gloves. Why would you use gloves in a warm September afternoon in California? And now you see how low the profile of that car is. So the hair is barely covered. So to get rid of the wind, people have to duck into the car to get behind the very, very small windscreen, which does not provide any good overview over the street, because you are very, very low to the ground. And so you have to duck and cover some like that. And this car is a racing car, which was legal for being used on the road, but its purpose was a racing car. We see that on several things. First of all, they got a sticker here with a starting number. I think that is very uncommon in usual cars. Secondly, the fixing of the engine bay, which is a mid-engined car, so the engine sits between the two axles. It's just here with the lock. And also, he's got two stripes on the back fender. The red stripes were the indication that this was a racing car from Porsche. All these Porsches, they were equipped with the red. You see it in the black and white picture, you don't see it, with the red stripes to indicate it is a racing car. Nevertheless, the car was being equipped with a license plate, so it was allowed to drive it on public roads. But once for all, it is a racing car. You see it with the buckle here, you see it at the racing stripes, and you see it at the starting number, okay? Usually, if you take a car to the race, you have it on a trailer because it is not legal to drive it on the road, or you put the stickers on just before the race on the racetrack. But he chose, on the advice of his mechanic, to drive in the engine before the race started, which is very strange because he was in the possession of that car for exactly 13 days and he had also an accident with the car, so he must have driven it before. You see, there are so many things to consider. What is the real truth from different sources? I hope it is very, very interesting to learn all the facts about that. The car was a very sneaky one. Even for today's standard, because of its low profile, this car achieves a high top speed, although it has not that much horsepower. Officially, it has 110 horsepower, but he's got a very low drag coefficient. Okay? So if you have a rectangular object, for example, a cube or a long cylinder, it has a high drag coefficient, which means you need more power to achieve a certain speed. Or if you have a very streamlined body like this teardrop shape here, yeah, you will achieve a very high velocity or a very high speed, because the air can flow underneath and above without that much resistance comparison as a cube. Okay. So that's that. These are the coefficients. There are several indications of Porsche, which makes it very, very hard to estimate what the real speed of the car could achieve. Because the car was equipped with several windshields. A single windshield for just a single driver, then the double windshield, and then a double windshield with A-pillars. And also a higher back, etc. I don't want to bother you with all the technical details, but it's very hard to estimate what's what, okay? These are the gear ratios of that car. It's got just a manual four gear. Problem is, the car was equipped with several different gear ratios. So we cannot estimate the speed by the gear ratio alone. Yeah, you see how many things, if you just have one number, one indication, you cannot tell, oh yeah, I got the gear ratio, I don't know how much. No, you won't. Only Porsche knew with the number of the car what gear ratio that car had, in my humble opinion. And the brakes weren't that good because they were just drum brakes. We're speaking about 1955 with a very, very light vehicle. The usual weight of that vehicle must be somewhere around 1,200 pounds.
Yeah, that's very light, Michael.
Yeah. With the people, maybe 1,500. Yeah, you see 1,800 with the people. That's the old one. The old one he had was 70 horsepower, 75 with 830 kilograms or 1,800. And the newer car had 110 horsepower with 250 pounds less. I have to equal that here. It's about, must be about 1,300 pounds, something like that. Okay? That's not much. Yeah, and he bought it for 4,000. It was been sold for 4,200 Deutschmarks. And yeah, that's him at Competition Motors in his brand new car. Considering the fact that this car already has the stripes and the starting number when he took off. That's what I'm telling you. So people tell about he's got a coefficient value of 0.31. Yeah, but you see that I found several documentaries about the car and yeah, they weren't all that true. And I think that if you really want to know the motive or the real fascination story about James Dean, that we should close it down now because it will get very technical in the next episode and you will be very much surprised how many people have been involved in that accident. And yeah, I think that the accident of James Dean is the most interesting thing to solve the riddle. If it was an accident, if it happened by accident, or if James Dean was speeding or not. Mm-hmm. Yeah. You see, I know it has not much to do with the Bible at the moment.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But we're talking about American Rebel, and we're talking about someone who was idolized and even had the impact that several people committed suicide after his death. Yeah, and that is a very strange thing. That's a very strange thing. That means that James Dean was being seen as a god from these people, or as an idol. And I found that very, very strange. So I think we have covered the 1 hour mark, and I think we shall close it down. I don't know if Red has any more questions about that, or he's just been curious to learn what's it all about, because in the next episode we can reveal so many people, and I think that you will see that everybody in this industry is not a Christian, because they all want to go out and have some fun. Okay, that's it for today, because I don't want to do a large session now.
Very good, Michael. I have no real comments other than to thank you for presenting us this information, and we'll catch up on the next session. So, God bless. Maranatha.